Flying cars are the ultimate technology that never was. A staple of science fiction, many thought they were just around the corner. Today, flying cars are a shining example of our technological hubris. All hype, but devoid from reality. As a result, flying cars never amounted to anything. Well, maybe not. Flying cars have long been a staple of pop futurism, perhaps one of the most iconic future technologies. But while other technologies have seen massive growth and progress, flying cars have remained grounded. And that's the last pun, I promise. Flying cars aren't actually vaporware. In fact, they exist, and concepts have been around for a long time, but you've probably never seen one in person, because they've struggled to make it to market. That's because they're expensive, and have a major drawback. But what is that drawback?
Runways.
For flying cars, you drive to your nearest runway, take off, land near your destination, and then drive to your final destination. It certainly saves you arranging transport to and from runways. Still, you need a runway near you and near the places that you want to go. So I guess what you really want is a helicopter. Helicopters can take off and land vertically, so they don't need much space. Helicopters have been around for a long time, so why don't you own one? Well, they're expensive. If you want to buy a new budget helicopter, it will set you back about $250,000. That's fairly expensive, but the costs don't stop there. Maintenance, insurance, storage. Helicopters cost a magnitude more to run per year than your car. Not to mention, flying helicopters is notoriously difficult. Training to fly will take 30 flight hours and cost at least $10,000. While it may be possible to shrink these costs, it doesn't look like helicopters will become a popular personal transport system anytime soon. So I guess our dreams of a fast aerial commute are over.
Not so fast.
Have you considered autonomous, electric, vertical takeoff and landing of manned aerial vehicles? Quite the catchy name. But I'm just going to call them MAVS for the rest of this video. Although EVTOL is also quite a popular name for them. Maybe MAVS are the flying cars we always wanted, precisely because they're not flying cars. By ditching the car bit, MAVS circumvent the runway problem and promise to be a much cheaper alternative to helicopters. But what is a MAV, and why does it show more promise than traditional helicopters? While MAVs may look like just another type of helicopter, they share a lot more in common with consumer drones.
Side note, drone means UAV, or unmanned aerial vehicle. Most consumer drones are quadcopter or multi-rotor designs. Since many of these have high levels of autonomous capability, I'm just going to call them drones like everyone else. Also, passenger drone is another name for MAVs.
With MAVs, there are many types, and the nomenclature can get confusing. I'm going to focus on electric multi-rotor designs. So how do they differ from helicopters, and why do they show more promise? The electric multi-rotor offers some distinct advantages. They have both greater stability and maneuverability. Though if you've seen stunt helicopters, you might be surprised how agile they can be. Still, they can't compete with multi-rotors. Stability is important, especially if you want to be able to fly it yourself. Learning to fly MAVs is much easier, and thus has the potential to be much cheaper, though it is regulation dependent. But that's if you even need to learn at all. Autonomous functions for MAVs are already quite advanced, as anyone who's flown a top-end drone can attest.
The benefits don't stop there though.
Multi-rotors allow for redundancy. If a rotor fails, MAVs can still fly. This is important because a simple analysis suggests that helicopters are 85 times more dangerous than cars, a big problem for a mass transport system. But perhaps the most important factor is cost. Having one single rotor providing all your lift is very demanding. Multi-rotors are much simpler in design as is their electric powertrain. As a result, MAVS are much better suited for mass production. This will likely be key for MAVS to become an affordable transport method. So, if MAVS are so great, why aren't you commuting to work in one? Well, I'm going to do a whole video detailing the challenges facing MAVS and how we might solve them. But for now, I'm just going to list the key difficulties. Cost, regulation, noise, safety, range, practicality, air traffic management, infrastructure, public perception, operating conditions. So, a few minor things. In fact, these challenges are so numerous that flying cars have attracted a number of vocal critics. None more so than Elon Musk, who cites noise as the primary concern. Despite these criticisms, MAVS are attracting significant investment, and a number of companies with big backing are getting involved. No, really, I was shocked when I found out how many. Once again, I'm just going to list these vehicles for now, because I need a full video to cover them properly. So let's start with the actual flying cars. Aeromobile 4.0, Terrafugia Transition, PAL-V Liberty, although that is a VTOL, so it doesn't need a runway. What about EVTOL MAVS though? There are nearly 100 EVTOL vehicles under development. Many of those won't make their first flight, so I'm just going to focus on those that have already taken to the air. EHang 184, Chinese government and venture capital backed. Astro Elroy. Lilium Jet. Vertical Aerospace. Aurora EVTOL. Shorefly Workhorse. Volocopter 2X, partnered with Intel and Daimler backed. If that's not enough, there's some big players backing EVTOL vehicles. Google co-founder and Alphabet CEO Larry Page is funding three vehicles. Kitty Hawk Flyer, Kitty Hawk Cora, Opener Blackfly. Thought we were done? Here's some big companies you've probably heard of. Bell, Rolls-Royce, Toyota, Boeing, Airbus, Uber. With so many companies backing this technology, there's certainly an industry belief that these vehicles are viable and suggests that MAVS might be closer to reality than many people realize. But what is the point in a MAV if you aren't able to fly them anywhere? I'm going to look at regulatory challenges as part of the next video, but for now, let's take a quick look at which places have scheduled MAV testing with plans to open commercial activities. Leading the way is Dubai, which is committed to being the first city with a commercial flying taxi service. True to that endeavour, both Volocopter and EHang have conducted flight tests, with humans on board for the latter. While Dubai is likely to be the first, it won't be the only one. EHang is also currently testing in Guangzhou, China, while Volocopter starts testing in Singapore next year. Japan has committed to fast-track the introduction of commercial flying cars through regulatory and financial investment. New Zealand, Ingolstadt, Dallas, Los Angeles, Sydney, and several Indian cities all have plans for commercial flying taxis in the next few years. So, will I be able to fly one soon? Well, that depends. There's a huge range of approaches from the MAVS I mentioned before. Some are intended as aerial taxis, others are planned for personal transport, and some are intended for both. That means some MAVS are completely autonomous. You set the destination by tablet, and it flies you there. Others give you full control of flying the vehicle. Much like cars, there's a whole host of semi-autonomous technology that can be included for safety of the manually controlled vehicles. Since autonomous flying will almost certainly be mandatory for taxis, you will likely need to own a MAV if you want to fly one. The cheapest MAV intended for market is around $40,000, and it's available in most countries. But get this, it goes on sale next year. We're going to look at the viability of this vehicle in the next video. Ultimately, whether or not you'll be able to pilot one yourself will depend on the regulations of the country you're in. Before we wrap things up, I think it's a good idea to talk about why we might want MAVS. Many people concerned with the negatives of their introduction, and in many cases, that response is justified. In the next video, we will see the challenges posed by MAVS as significant. That said, little is mentioned of the benefits beyond they're cool. While I'm not going to attempt to model the economic impact of MAVS, I think it's important to point out some key areas where they may help us. The average person in the developed world spends over 8,000 hours commuting. That's a whole year of your life. That's more time than you'll spend socializing. It's more time than you'll spend in school. Unlike other transport systems, MAVS can travel virtually point to point. Not only that, they can travel at speeds much faster than can safely be done in cars. MAVS have the potential to drastically reduce commute times, but it remains to be seen if that potential will be realised. What would you do with an extra half year of your life? Hopefully not watch half a year's more Netflix. The impact is also financial. Congestion alone costs a staggering $300 billion per year in the US alone. Taken together, the worldwide costs of our slow commute is in the trillions of dollars. There are many other advantages, from fast, efficient logistics, reduced infrastructure costs, or even improved medical emergency response time. Too much to go through in this video. So, will MAVS become the dominant form of transport? We need to do a bit more work before we can confidently answer that question. Still, before researching this video, I had no idea that we might be on the cusp of that revolution. Flying cars are here, make no mistake. They will have some role in our transportation future, and that role might start as soon as next year. However, it remains to be seen whether they will become a local transport niche or our primary global transport. What we do know is there is a number of large companies and governments backing the latter. In that vein, we should revisit the opening sentiments of this video. Perhaps flying cars should no longer be considered an example of our technological hubris. More, a cautionary tale against getting too invested in the technology hype cycle. In the next video, we're going to look at the key challenges facing MAVS and how we might solve them. I will suggest a rough development roadmap, identify key milestones, and propose a timeline on MAV adoption. Perhaps even project what a future world with MAVS might look like.